If you're joining us once again, this is Truth to Live By, the radio and television broadcast ministry of Reasons for Faith International Ministries. I'm Dr. Miguel Gonzalez, your Bible teacher. Once again, we're going to continue our study in prophecy today, but before we do that, let's open up in prayer. Father, we thank you. We pray that as we spend time in your word and we explore what your word has to say about the future, that you would use that to create in us a sense of urgency and passion for carrying out your work in these last days in which we live. We thank you for your sovereignty, your grace, your love, and we give you all the praise and honor in Jesus' name. Amen. Okay, last week we ended our message by speaking about Israel's present. We were looking at the role of Israel in world history, or we already saw their past. We talked about the covenants that are important and that have a great deal to do with biblical prophecy. We talked about Israel's present. Now we're going to go ahead and just close out this section of Israel's role in world history by just quickly looking at Israel's future. And there's four points that I want to make regarding Israel's future in terms of what role they play in world history. First of all, they play a vital role, and I don't know if you're aware of this, but they play a vital role in starting the tribulation period. You know that once the church is raptured from the earth and the church is gone, Israel will sign a treaty or a covenant with the Antichrist, who will be heading up the Western Confederation of Nations. Once that treaty is signed, that marks the beginning of the tribulation period. Now, there may be a small gap of time between the rapture and the signing of that document, but once Israel signs that document where the Antichrist promises to protect and allows Israel to maintain their rights and their independence, that marks the beginning of the tribulation. In fact, in Daniel chapter 9, verse 27, it says, "He will confirm a covenant with many for 1 7." And it's talking about the Antichrist there. Second of all, in regard to Israel's future, Israel will be the focus of the tribulation period. Now, it is true that there's a couple of main things that are going to be occurring during the tribulation period. One is God is going to be judging the nations, the Gentile nations, because of their rejection, of the Messiah, their sin. But God goes back in the tribulation period and deals with the nation of Israel. In fact, we are told in Jeremiah chapter 30, verse 7, that the tribulation period is known as the time of Jacob's distress, or the time of Jacob's trouble. Israel is God's primary concern during the tribulation period is Israel. And he goes back to dealing with Israel since the church has been removed from the world scene. So let me make a couple of points regarding the focus of the tribulation, which is Israel itself. First of all, the tribulation will be a time of Israel's persecution. If you look at Revelation chapter 12, verses 1 through 17, you will find that Israel will be severely persecuted during the time of tribulation. Second, the tribulation will be a time of Israel's cleansing. And you can find passages to support that in Ezekiel chapter 20, verses 37 and 38, or Jeremiah 30:11. Thirdly, the tribulation will be a time of Israel's service, Revelation chapter 7, verse 3. Fourthly, the tribulation will be a time of Israel's war. And fifthly, during the tribulation, all people will suffer, but the focus is once again on the people, the nation of Israel. The third point regarding Israel's future is that Israel will initiate, listen, not only do they start play a significant role in starting the future tribulation, but they actually initiate the second coming of Christ. Christ returns at the end of the seven-year tribulation period because Israel prays for Christ's return. I want to look at quickly a passage in Matthew chapter 23, and this will help make the point that I'm trying to make right here. Matthew 23, verses 37 through 39. Listen to what it says here. O Jerusalem, Jerusalem, you who kill the prophets and stone those sent to you, how often I have longed to gather your children together as a hen gathers her chicks under her wings, but you were not willing. Look, your house is left to you desolate, for I tell you, you will not see me again until you say, blessed is the one who comes in the name of the Lord. Once the Jews recognize their circumstances and they recognize that they need the Lord to return, until they say what Jesus said they were going to say, he will not come again. But once they do, that will usher the second coming of Christ. Now remember, the rapture is God coming for the church. The second coming is God coming with the church in order to set up the millennium kingdom. So Israel will initiate the second coming of the Messiah. And lastly, regarding Israel's future, Israel will be the head of the nations in the Messianic kingdom. And we made that point a little bit last week in that message. Israel will rise to be the nation that God had prophesied it would become. And they will be blessed above every other nation during the millennium kingdom. And so in the future, Israel will be head of the nations in the Messianic kingdom. Now, we've ended at this point the chapter that I would have entitled Understanding the Role of Israel in World History, Both Past, Present, and Future. Now we want to actually start looking at the signs of the times and what is out there that helps us discern that we are indeed approaching those last days of which the Bible speaks. Let me read you a quote from 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 7. This is what Peter said, "The end of all things is near. Therefore be clear-minded and self-controlled so that you can pray." Listen, you know what Peter's saying here? And the Greek text, the reference in the Greek to the statement that he makes, "the end of all things is near," indicates the tense in which it's written, indicates a present reality with future consequences. In other words, this same verse could be rendered this way: the end of all things has already begun. Now, if that rendering is correct, if that rendering is a correct translation of the original Greek, then when did it begin? Oftentimes, when we talk about the end times, we're thinking about future events, and to a certain extent, we're correct by doing so, because we're looking at things that have not yet happened that are going to come to pass. But did you know that the Bible actually teaches us that we are already in the end times? If that is true, then when did the end times begin? Well, according to the Word of God and according to the New Testament, the end times began with the first coming of Jesus. When he came for the first time, the end times began, and they will end with his second coming, but they have already begun. For example, in Matthew chapter 24 and verse 30, Jesus said this, At that time, the sign of the Son of Man will appear in the sky, and all nations of the earth will mourn. They will see the Son of Man coming on the clouds of the sky with power and great glory. His return marks the end of all things. So with his first coming, the end times have begun. With his second coming, the end times end. Okay, now, in speaking in regard to the signs of the times, I want to make sure that we avoid two extremes, because you see many people out there who teach on prophecy take one extreme, but I want to avoid two extremes. First of all, we need to make sure that we are not apathetic or we scoff at Bible prophecy. we need to make sure that we take Bible prophecy seriously. Just because things don't happen in the time frame that we think they ought to or on our timetable doesn't mean that God is not constantly and currently active bringing about these events that will take place. God performs His role in prophecy when He does. And the timing of God is the perfect timing. Just because they don't occur within our timing doesn't mean that God is not acting or that these things are not going to happen. We need to make sure we don't take the extreme of becoming actually apathetic towards prophecy. We need to take prophecy seriously. If we don't take prophecy seriously, we are in essence underselling the prophetic teaching of the Bible. But we also want to avoid the second extreme. And the second extreme is the one that I made reference to, the fact that many who teach on prophecy actually take this extreme. We are to avoid sensationalism. Listen, it is beyond me why people need to sensationalize that which is already sensational. I mean, the events of which the Bible speaks concerning the future are already sensational. Why do they have to sensationalize the sensational even more? Oftentimes, and you know, it may not be the case with everybody, but oftentimes they do so because it best fits their sinful, unscriptural, and personal agenda for personal gain. So we need to avoid being apathetic to prophecy, and we need to avoid being sensational when it comes to teaching prophecy. All right. Now, the first thing that we need to cover here is how do we properly discern the signs of the times? In Matthew chapter 16 and verses 1 through 3, this is what Scripture says. The Pharisees and the Sadducees came to Jesus and tested Him by asking Him to show them a sign from heaven, as if He hadn't already shown them many signs. This is the arrogance and the stubbornness of man, in that in spite of all that God has already demonstrated and proven, we are still asking for signs. But nonetheless, they came and asked for an additional sign from heaven. He replied, "When evening comes, you say it will be fair weather, for the sky is red. And in the morning, today it will be stormy, for the sky is red and overcast. You know how to interpret the appearance of the sky, but you cannot interpret the signs of the times." Listen, Jesus was rebuking the Pharisees and the Sadducees for being able to interpret the weather based on the appearance of the sky, but failing to interpret the signs of the times. And listen, this is something that we need to be very careful of, because we don't want to be accused as a church of the same thing. I have said, and I will continue to say, that the Bible clearly teaches us that we are not to know the time of these future events. We are not to set dates, but we are able to discern the general period of time when these things are going to occur. And Jesus rebukes those who fail to exercise discernment and understanding and recognizing the signs of the times. Secondly, in Matthew 24, verses 32 and 35, listen to what Jesus said. This is the lesson of the fig tree. "Now learn this lesson from the fig tree. As soon as its twigs get tender and its leaves come out, you know that summer is near. Even so, when you see all these things," and these are the things that He had spoken of in previous verses, "you know that it is near, right at the door. I tell you the truth, this generation will certainly not pass away until all these things have happened. Heaven and earth will pass away, but my words will never pass away." What is the lesson of the fig tree? Listen, if we are able to determine the season because of a fig tree, why is it, Christ says, that we're not able to recognize when the end times are coming by failing to recognize the signs of the times? Listen, we do not want to be found guilty of committing the same of being guilty of the same thing that the Pharisees and Sadducees. We need to learn from his rebuke because of their failure to discern, and we need to learn a lesson of the fig tree. Another thing that I want to say before we actually get into the signs of the times is I want to talk about the dark shadow illustration. I know you have experienced this. I know everybody has, and that's why I want to use it as an illustration. Have you ever seen that when you're out walking, and if you're walking and you have the sun behind you, when you're walking, you're able to see your shadow in front of you? Now, we all know that the shadow is not us, but the shadow tells potentially others that we are coming right behind it. In other words, to make the point clear, the signs of the times operate like that shadow that you often see of yourself when you're walking and the sun is behind you. You are not the shadow, but the shadow warns people that you are not far behind. That's the point I'm attempting to make. The signs of the times are like that shadow. They're not the end times, but they are the shadow that warns us that the end times or the last days are coming shortly. And we need to remember that, because even though we cannot set the date, we can recognize those signs and know that the coming is, that the end times are near. Now let's look at some of the signs of the times that the Bible speaks about. In 2 Peter chapter 3, verses 3 through 4, this is what Peter says. First of all, you must understand that in the last days, scoffers will come, scoffing and following their own evil desires. They will say, "Where is this coming he promised? Ever since our fathers died, everything goes on as it has since the beginning of creation." You know what Peter says? One of the signs of the times is going to be scoffers, lust, and unbelief. Again, I just said this a few minutes ago, I say it again. Just because God operates on a different timetable than we do does not mean that God has fallen asleep behind the wheel. God works out his decrees and works out his will when he does. But people assume that because the statement was made and nothing's happened in this period of time, that surely either it's not true or God has changed his mind. And they scoff. And listen to what Peter said. They follow their own evil desires, and he's making a reference in essence to lust. Do we have to say anything else about lust in today's generation? I know every generation has talked about it, but certainly I think we've reached a peak when it comes to the level of people following their own evil desires. And you know what tends to happen? When people question whether things are actually going to happen, and things don't happen on their timetable, they actually stop believing what God has said. So Peter said that in the last days, one of the signs of the times will be scoffers, lust, and unbelief. Let me give you another one. In Matthew chapter 24, verses 37 through 39, listen to what the Bible says there. As it was in the days of Noah, so it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. For in the days before the flood, people were eating and drinking, marrying and giving in marriage, up to the day Noah entered the ark, and they knew nothing about what would happen until the flood came and took them all away. This is how it will be at the coming of the Son of Man. You know what the Bible tells us? You know what we're being told right there? That there will be a callousness and carelessness concerning Christ and his things as there are in the present time. Listen, I find this text we just read quite curious. We know that the Bible tells us that it took a great deal of time for Noah to construct the ark, and that during that time, the world was being warned of the flood that was about to come over them. And in spite of all the warnings, and in spite of Noah constructing this ark, we are told in this text that apparently they still knew nothing about what would happen, even though Noah had been warning them. Listen, you know what, in essence, you know what this text is telling us? That in the last days, there will be religious unconcern, as they were in the days of Noah. Listen, in the days of Noah, all they were worried about was two things: eating and drinking, and marrying and giving to in marriage. That's all they were concerned about: eating, drinking, and propagating. Well, if we look at the present day, it appears that we are once again experiencing a great deal of religious unconcern. Listen, just kind of a sidebar here. I don't know why people who have read their Bibles, who have attended good churches to listen to preachers preach good sermons, who have heard the gospel over and over the time of their life, continually insist on rejecting Jesus Christ. I don't understand why mankind would want to live without God as part of their life. I mean, listen, if you remove God from your life, you're removing the only thing that is worth even living for. The truth of the matter is that if all I have to live for is the life that I can make for myself apart from a personal relationship with the living God, let me tell you something, folks. That's not much of a life to look forward to living. And I refuse to believe that God doesn't exist, and that we were created by nothing more than chance, and that all of life is just this, what we experience presently, and that at some point when our life ends, it all ends. Life has a lot more meaning than what those who do not want to believe in the existence of God tell you there is. That is nothing more. That is not life, folks. That is nothing more than just merely existing. And in the present day, there is such religious unconcern that I think we're seeing the fulfillment of that sign of the time now. People just don't care. Whatever. People say they believe a certain thing, but they don't live as though they believe it, which leads me to believe that they really don't believe it. And there's a religious unconcern. And I think that leaves a tremendous void in the life of every person who takes that position. Well, we're coming to the end of this particular program, so we're going to end our study right here. We are talking about discerning the signs of the times, and we're looking at the actual signs of the times that are given to us in Scripture. First was unbelievers, lust, unbelief, lust, and scoffers, and then religious unconcern. Next week we will pick up again where we're ending today, and we will continue to look at the signs of the times. Father, we thank you for your faithfulness, your love. We thank you for your word, for every word in your word. Just give us a pure heart and a passion to live our lives for the glory of the Lord Jesus. For it is in his name that we pray. Amen. We want to thank you for having spent the last 30 minutes with us. We pray that this program has been a blessing to you. Reasons, Truth to Live By is a television and radio ministry of Reasons for Faith International Ministries. It is our prayer that Christ would be glorified through this program by bringing to himself people into a personal relationship with him, and by strengthening and equipping Christians for service. We want to make sure we extend an invitation for you to come back next week. We will continue this series on prophecy. You don't want to miss any single episode of this exciting study. We are going to look at God's Word, explore God's Word, and discover what it is that the Bible has to say about the future of this country, the future of the world, and the future of the world's inhabitants. Our mission is to teach the truth from God's Word and to present and proclaim the gospel of Christ. We want to make sure we give people an opportunity at the end of every program and invite them to give their hearts and their lives to the Lord Jesus. If you so feel led today by the Spirit to trust Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, we want to give you that opportunity. And if you're a Christian, but you're not walking with the Lord and you're not in a dynamic relationship with Him, we want you as well to make a fresh commitment to the Lord even tonight. If you need to pray for salvation, I want you to just repeat this prayer after me. Dear Lord Jesus, I acknowledge my sin and I confess and repent of my sin. I ask you, Lord, to forgive me. I ask you to come into my heart and create in me a new creation. I thank you, Lord, for your love. I thank you for your mercy, your grace, and your compassion. I know I cannot save myself, and I know I can contribute nothing to my own salvation. I trust you and you alone to save me. You are the only hope for salvation that I have. Come into my heart as I ask you to become my Lord and my Savior. In Jesus' name I pray, amen. If you have prayed this prayer, I can tell you on the authority of the Word of God that you are now forgiven. You are a child of the living God. You are in a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. If you've prayed this prayer and you meant it from your heart, I want you to let us know. If you're a Christian and you're making a fresh commitment to the Lord and you're asking Him to restore your fellowship with Him and to restore the joy of your salvation, I want you to contact us as well. We want to make sure that we provide you with our contact information. We're going to give you that at the end. Send us your prayer request if you so desire, and let us know what the Lord is doing as a result of this program in your life. Make sure you have a pen and paper so that when we provide you with our contact information, which will appear on your screen in a moment, you can take that information down. You can contact us by phone, email, or mail. We are looking forward to hearing from you. We want to thank you again for having spent the last 30 minutes with us. Please make sure you tune in next week, same time, same day, so that you may continue to study God's Word along with us and you may find out what it is that God has in store for this world. We want to thank you. We pray that God would richly bless you, and we will see you next week.